Okay, so we're going to start recording. Well, it's 7 on the dot, so let's start. I'm anxious to get to this. Hi, everyone. My name's Jocelyn from the Shelter Island Library. Tonight, Steve Kuhn is going to share stories from 50 years as a clammer on the Great South Bay. He wrote a book called Hard Work, My Life as a Clammer on the Great South Bay. And it chronicles a way of life that's really disappearing, and very few people do what he did all those years. So I'm really looking forward to this. And I just want to mention that his website is clampower.org. And you can find out, we'll show you a video from that, but that's where you can get the book. So with that, I'll just say, welcome, Steve Kuhn. Thank you for being here.
Well, thank you for having me. I'll just introduce myself. Again, I'm 75 years old, and I've been clamming for over 50 years on the Great South Bay. I still work, but only a couple days a week, as this job is a very strenuous physical job. And when you get older, the aches and pains get longer, and it's a lot harder to do than when you were younger. So as I said, I've been clamming for over 50 years. I started writing this book around 10 years ago. And I finally got to the point where I said, I better finish this before I forget what I want to say. So basically what happened is that we had the pandemic and I was able to finish the book. So I had a couple reasons for writing it. One, I always thought I had a pretty interesting life and I wanted to share that with people. And also clamming is a way of life and it's kind of a dying way of life. When I started clamming back in the late 60s, there were thousands of people clamming, and now it's dwindled down to a mere few. So in a way, it's kind of dying and fading, and I wanted to be able to pass that down to other generations. And when you clam and you tell people you're a clammer or a clam digger, their eyes light up because it's not like an everyday job. You're not behind a computer. You're not working 9 to 5. You're making your own hours and you're doing your own thing. And it's a bit of romance around it. People think, oh, you're on the water. This is great. Fresh air, sunshine. You're doing what you want to do. And all of that is true. But what I named this book Hard Work. And there's a reason for that. Because if you're going to make this your job, it is hard work. When I started clamming, I was like a young kid and kind of going through the motions. And when I decided to do this full time, everything changed. And you work 5.5 days a week, week in and week out. You ask any clam digger and what they miss most about it, they always remember the beautiful days and when they did really good. But there's a lot of days that aren't like that. It could be raining, it could be snow, and it could be sleet, thunderstorms, pea soup fog. There's a lot that goes into it besides that. So what I wanted to convey to people was that this is a really, really hard job, but I loved it. And I really enjoyed my job. And that's why I still do it. Okay. I want to read a passage from the book I wrote. And this is the first chapter. And it was called The Game. And I'll just explain a few things. I was about 20 years old. This was about maybe 2 years after I'd started clamming. And when you're 20 years old, 19, 20, you really don't know exactly what you want to do in your life. So I was out working on the bay one day, and this is what I wrote. One Saturday afternoon in late October or early November, I was clamming on the bay off of East Islip. I was working fairly close to shore in about 5 to 6 feet of water. The weather that day was cold, damp, and dreary. Dark gray clouds covered the sky, and a 10 to 15 mile an hour northeast wind with the light to intermittent rain was falling. Oftentimes it was like this at this time of the year. On shore, there was a football game going on. Sound travels on the wind, and I could hear everything. The band was playing, the fans were cheering. I could hear the public address announcer describing the plays. When a touchdown was scored, there was a huge roar from the crowd, and the band played the school's fight song. I felt if I was actually at the game, although I wasn't. I looked around, and as far as I could see, there wasn't another soul on the water. I thought to myself, this is pretty neat. There are hundreds of people on land into this football game, and no one even knows that I'm out here. They were doing their thing, and I was doing mine. I really did want to be exactly where I was, and I thought that this is really part of being a Bayman, just doing your own thing. I said to myself that if I can be out here on a cold, wet, damp day at this time of year, I must really like what I'm doing, and I did. I wrote this because this is kind of like a, I guess you could say, an aha moment. I said, I really like this job, and it was cold and nasty, and being 20 years old, it didn't bother me one bit. It was like impervious to the elements. I know if I go out now and it's like that, I go, I'm freezing. This is not it. But back then, it didn't bother me. So I decided, you know what, I'm going to do this. And also, one of the reasons was that when I started clamming, a friend of mine and myself, we went out together, and we both worked off the same boat. Well, my friend couldn't go to work that day, so I worked off the boat by myself. And I caught a lot of clams compared to what we were normally doing. Later, I realized probably that was because I was the only person on the boat and there weren't two of us. So anyway, that was like I said, an aha moment. And I said, you know, I really do like doing what I'm doing. So now I want to zip ahead to the first day that I ever went clamming. I had a friend who'd been clamming about 6 months before myself, right? And there was a bunch of us, and we worked at a nursery. And he said to me one day, you want to go out clamming? And I said, oh, yeah, sure, I'd like to try it. And back then, there were a lot of people clamming. The clam boats were all over the bay. So he called me up. I met him at his boat, and we went to work. It took about, I'd say, 15 to 20 minutes to get there. And it was a beautiful, beautiful day in the spring. It was like in the high 60s, low 70s. There were little ripples on the water. The sun was out. And my eyes lit up. I said, wow, this is really something. I said, boy, I don't know. For some reason, like a lot of people, I really like being out on the water. So we went to work. And he set up a rake for me. And he had his rake, showed me what to do. We put the rakes in the water, and I watched him, and we started pulling on him. And we worked in a place called Hexa Park. And the bottom was, it's like a training ground almost. It was soft sand, and the only thing there were clams. Back then, there was a lot more clams than there are now. So to make a long story short, we worked, I don't know, maybe 6 hours or whatever, and I caught two bushels of clams. And he caught 2 bushels of clams. There's probably 1,000 to 1,200 clams in those 2 bushels of clams. And he said to me, he goes, you know, that's really good for somebody who's never worked before. And that made me feel good. I said, I caught the same as he did, right? So I said, this is great. Well, my muscles were sore. My hands turned to chopped meat. I had blisters. But everything, it was kind of a good soreness, if I could call it that. We got paid $14 a bushel, so I made $28 that day. Well, I know that doesn't sound like a lot of money, but my take-home pay at the nursery was $89 for the week. So I said to myself, I computed in my head, I said, geez, if I work 5 days, I can make $140 a week. That's way more than I'm making now. But it wasn't the money. It was like, it was just such a nice, beautiful day. And every clam digger, like I said, if you ask them, you take your best day or the day you have and you multiply it by 5 and you say, well, that's what I'm going to do. Well, it doesn't work like that because in between, like I said, there's rain or there's 40 mile an hour winds or there's something going on. But this was it. I said I was hooked. So that's what I decided. I'm going to do that. So we quit the nursery and my friend and I, Bill, we decided that we were going to get a boat together. So we looked around. We found a boat in Bayshore. And it was a 24-foot decked over Garvey. It was on the back of a canal. We had to walk through this driveway, this big old Victorian house. We went back there and we looked at it and we said, oh, man, we'll take that. Well, we didn't know. We actually nicknamed the boat the Leak and Lena because if we didn't have a bilge pump in it, it would have sunk. The bottom was flapping around and that. So what happened is we needed a motor. It didn't have a motor. My friend found a 40 horsepower Johnson motor and we paid $300 for the motor and $300 for the boat. We got the motor, we walked it down the driveway and put it on the boat. So we started to sail home. We said, all right, we gotta go find a place to dock this thing now. So we head back to Sable, and there was an apartment complex with a little marina and a bunch of houses around the marina. Well, there was nobody in it, so we tied the boat up there and just put it in there. Well, about 2 weeks later, we found a note on the windshield that said, you better move this hunk of junk and get it out of here because this is somebody's private dock space. So with that, we took the boat and we started to go down Browns River, which was the next creek over. We were going down Browns River and we sailed up, and it was a friend of mine at the dock as we neared the Cherry Grove Ferry, this guy, Tom. And I'd gone to high school with Tom, and he saw us and he said, what are you guys doing? So we told him, we said, we're looking for a dock space. So he says, oh, pull it in here. Right. So we said, all right. So we pulled it in. We talked to him and we tied the boat up. That night, we went out to a bar. We had a few drinks. We ran into Tom, and I never asked him, but he said, I talked to my father and he said, you could leave the boat there. So just like that, we had a dock space. That was 50 something years ago. It's amazing how things just kind of happened. The ferry was sold. The Cherry Grove Ferry was sold and bought by the Pines Ferry, which a family by the name of Steins owned that. And when Tom and his family sold the ferry, he said, we grandfathered you in. Now, I don't know if he was kidding or not, but we were able to keep the boat at the Pines Ferry for the rest of the time. So that was a long time, and those people were so nice to us and really, really helped us out. Okay. So we had a dock space, and I was clamming in the summer and going to school in the fall and in the winter, and I would come back in the summers. Bill and I, we worked together off the same boat. We worked at Hexa Park, and we learned how to clam slowly. You know, back then we were young. Nobody could tell us anything. If it was hot, I'd jump in the water and go swimming. If there were fish around, I'd get the fishing pole out and I'd throw the line in and go fishing. We kind of did whatever we want. If it rained, we'd pack it up and go home. We were having a good time. It was great. It was a great time in my life. Is we were happy and doing what we wanted to do. Well, after I think it was 2 years or 2.5 years of working together on the boat, we got to know people out there. And most guys, they didn't really want to tell you a lot because you had to figure this out for yourself. Because like I said, the clams were there for everyone. And if they told you something, well, you're going to catch some of their clams. So they didn't really want to tell yourself. So anyway, we got to be friends with some people. And there was this one guy there named Rocky. And his nickname was Rocky because he was always singing the Beatles song, Rocky Raccoon, right? So I got to know Rocky, and he was a great guy. Rocky said to me one day, why do you only clam here? I said, well, this is the only place I know. Sometimes we would see him, and then for like a couple of weeks, he'd be gone. So he goes, listen, he goes, I go all over the bay. He goes, you know, and it depends on the conditions. And he knew a lot more than me because he'd been clamming like 4 or 5 years before I started. So he goes, I'm going to go to Bayport tomorrow. And he goes, why don't you meet me and we'll go there. So I said, all right, I'll try that. By then, Bill and I had split up. I had the boat. And Bill got the motor, and I was on the boat by myself, and Bill was working by himself. But I went with Rocky, and I met him the next day at Bayport. And I met his two friends, Clyde and Bill. And these guys had all been clamming 3, 4, 5 years more than I had, and they knew a lot more. And they were way better than I. And I looked at these guys in awe, and I said, oh, my God, look at these guys, how hard they work. Boy, can they catch clams? This is something, right? So I decided, well, I gotta see how this works. I'm gonna stop and I'm gonna listen and pay attention and find out what's going on. And we would talk about rakes and how much pole to let out and what type of rake to use and how long a teeth and all. And I was in awe of these guys. Clyde was so strong, he could rip the rake right through the bottom. Bill was so steady, he could just, when he started at 7 a.m, at 3 p.m, he was pulling on the rake the same way. And Rocky, my friend, Rocky had a finesse technique where he had such a feel for the bottom that he could kind of tickle the clams out of the bottom, but he wouldn't work as long as the other guys. He'd pack it in and he would go home after a while. So I decided to listen and learn, and I gradually got better and better. And I would say, as much as clamming is brute physical work, and it really is, you have to develop a feel for the bay bottom. And some guys get it and some guys never do. Well, I was really starting to get that feel. And that entails paying attention to little details, what the tide's doing, what the wind's doing, the type of bottom you're in, where the edges are, all of that stuff. And it has to be learned over time. It doesn't come right away. You pick up things here, you pick up things there, and after a while, you get to put it all together. So I gradually got better and better and better at clamming. And it took a couple years, and I got to be as good as those guys, just as good. And I, you know, back then, it was competition. Everybody was trying, one guy was trying to beat the other guy, right? So if you had 4 bushels of clams and the other guy had 5 bushels of clams, you wanted to catch 5 bushels of clams. Well, you wanted to catch 6 bushels of clams. So we were all like pushing ourselves and we got to be really, really good. And those three guys I hung out with, and they were some of the best years of my life. We had so much fun and we worked. We worked 5.5 days a week, no matter what. It had to blow 40 miles an hour for us to stay home in the summer. We just went to work every day. And you just kind of get used to working hard. So when I decided to keep up with these guys, there was no more jumping in the bay when it was hot. It was no more fishing. All we did was work, and a day consisted of 7, 7.5 hours, 8 hours, make a drift. At the end of the drift, you eat something and move back up and do it again. Sat down for 15 to 20 minutes for lunch, and that was it. We were almost like machines out there, but that's what we did, and we loved it. We loved it. We just got to be better and better at it, and it was a great way to spend your life. It was just what we were doing. We were so into this. And it took a while. Like I said, I've been clamming for 50 something years. And this was probably 6 or 7 years after I started that I really started to pick this up. So I'm going to talk right now. We had, you know, 4 seasons. You got spring, summer, fall, and winter. All the seasons are different things you do, different techniques. In the spring, the winds blow out of the south a lot, and we would work over by the Fire Island side. And you're close to the shore, and you were somewhat protected. And the shallow water would warm up faster than the deeper water, and the clams would come up there. And over there, you could see the bottom on a clear day. You know, we were in like 5 feet of water. You could see grass patches and sand, and you could see shells. You could see everything, which was a big advantage. So we would work over to the beach, and it was almost like clockwork. By the third week in April, the clams would come up to the top, and we could pull short teeth and skim over the bottom and fly. And when the wind blew, we just kind of hung on, but we could really throw clams in the boat. When the clams go down, you can't do that. You have to pull longer teeth, and you can't move as fast. You can't cover as much bottom, and you don't do as well. But from April, I would say to mid-June, we would do really, really good. And then what would happen, the water would heat up and it seemed like the clams would go down a little bit. So then we would move out for the summer into the deeper water, which was like 10 feet, 11 feet, 9 feet, about there. And out in the middle of the bay were a lot of shell beds, giant oyster beds. And there were clams in the oyster beds and especially on the edge of the oyster beds. And you had to just kind of form a picture in your mind of how the shell beds lay. And you were able to do that. And when you got to the edge, you would stuff the rake with clams. We used to love to do that. And a lot of times in the summer, the wind didn't blow. It was, you know, it was flat or hot. So it was a good place to work in the shells. So that's how we spent the summers. And then in the fall, sometimes we would work on the beach, and sometimes we would work in the deep water, depending on what the conditions are. We'd work kind of all over. And finally, in the winter, we would kind of work close to Long Island shore because we were somewhat protected. You get a lot of north winds, especially if you went out in the ice. And it was a lot of ice. We've been out in ice that's 7-8 inches thick. And you break a hole in ice, and you'd be working there. And if the ice would move, you'd have to move because you wouldn't have a choice. But we always went out with a bunch of friends because if something happened, at least we had a safety net. One of us could tow the other in. As far as weather goes, you just about name any condition, and I've been out. Wind, fog, rain, snow, sleet, ice, thunderstorms, you name it. I've been out in it. Probably some of the worst were thunderstorms because they would come out of nowhere and you get 40 mile an hour winds and lightning bolts. And sometimes you would get caught out there and put the anchor out and put your head down and just let it pass through. Most of the times they lasted a half hour or so. And a lot of times after that, the sun would come out, but it would get really nasty. Sometimes you try to figure out which way the storm was going. Is it going to go south of you? Is it going to go north of you? When sometimes you didn't have a choice, it would just come right out of the middle of the bay and nowhere, and you couldn't get out of there. I don't know how many times I had to take off and tie up in some creek or marina and wait for it to pass, but I did that a lot too. Let me see. I want to talk about one day I had what I call the best day of clamming that I ever had in my life. I learned to play clam in a place called Blue Point, and we call this place the Reef. And basically what it was, Blue Point was like, I describe it as a hand that went out into the bay. And at the top of that hand, it was like 4 or 5 feet of water. It was a point of land. And on either side of it was like 9, 10, 11 feet of water. And on the west side, we had huge oyster beds. And on the east side, it went from like five feet to like 10 feet. It was a real sharp edge. Well, that's where I learned to clam. So I knew that that bottom like the back of my hand. One day I went out and there were about 20 boats there. Blue Point had been closed for 5 years because of conservation, because of pollution. And there were rumors that it was going to open up, but it was all based on rainfall. And I could have sworn it rained, but I was going out east to work. So I went over there and I saw these boats and I saw a friend of mine, Red, and I said, is this open? He goes, yeah, open. I said, oh my God. So, all right, I set the rake up. Well, I went to the edge on the east side where it goes from 5 to 10 feet of water. And the clams there after 5 years, nobody working, was set up really thick. You could sit right on the edge and it was flat calm. I could make 3 grabs and catch 50 or 60 clams a grab and do it really fast. Well, the 20 boats went to 200 boats and the 200 went to 500 boats and the 500 went to 700 or 800 boats. And everybody and their grandmother, everybody who had a part-time job came out to this, to Blue Point. We never saw so many boats. I was in front of the pack because the guys that were outside, the edge wasn't so steep there. And you didn't know the bottom, it was easier to work. So I worked this edge and it went all the way into shore almost. I'd say an eighth of a mile. I caught six or seven bushels of clams in the first 2.5 hours. And a friend of mine had his brother on the boat. So I snagged him. Because I didn't count the clams. I had to have, so I said, do you want to count? And he goes, sure. So it was kind of neat. He counted all the clams for me. So we put, I think it was 480 clams in a bushel. So he counted them and I paid him $5 a bushel. And back then that was good. And he was happy. He was really happy. He was a young kid. He says, oh my God. So I caught At the end of the day, I had 15 and a half bushels of clams. That was the most clams I'd ever caught in the Great South Bay. And it was late, and there were no cell phones or anything like that. I paid him $85, and he was in heaven, and so was I. And it was right before Christmas, and the price of clams was high. I got home, and my wife said, "Where have you been?" Like I said, there were no cell phones. She goes, "You're late." I go, "Well," I said, "guess what I caught?" So she said, "What? 4 bushels? I said, "No more. 6? No more." So finally I told her. She goes, "Oh, wow, God, you can stay out anytime you want after that. That's fine with me." Two tickets to Barbados, January day that I ever had. Blue Point was open, and the next day I think I went out and I caught 8 bushels of clams. And the day after that, it was 4 degrees and the bay froze over and I caught 2 bushels of clams. And that was that. And after it was 700 boats there, it got beat up pretty fast. But like I said, that'll be a day that I always remember. When you're clamming for 50 years, a lot of things happen to you, a lot of interesting stories. I'll just relate a few of them to you. I wanted to put these in the book because these are things that happened to me over all that time. Okay. I probably rescued about 2 or 3 or 4 people who've fallen through the ice. One guy, I'll never forget, we were working in this place called, and we would cut holes on the ice and walk out. Cut a hole in the ice, he was over at night. This was an older guy, and he was walking along and he didn't pay attention. He fell right through through the hole. He couldn't get out. So my friend Don and I went over and we for sure, and it was probably a quarter of a mile, and he had one boot on and a sock on his other foot. He lost his other boot and he ran. It was cold in the way in. And so that was one time. Another time I was working in the pea soup fog, and I heard a little runabout come up to me, right? And it was a girl in a little boat, and she was lost in the fog. And she asked me, "How do you get to Davis Park?" So she said, "Oh, thank you." Half hour later, I hear a boot, and it's so I took my rake, put it on the boat, and I said, "Follow me," and I took her to Davis Park. I know what it's like because that happened to me when it's really soupy foggy. If you don't have a GPS back then, I'm not even sure if we had those, but a compass, you can get really lost, especially if it's flat calm. You don't have a wind direction to gauge yourself. So she thanked me up and down for getting her to Davis Park. And another time, the one time, there was a guy with a rowboat rowing inshore, and I was about a mile out in the bay. Well, when I went out, the wind was blowing about 5 miles an hour. By the time he got out there, it was like that. But a half hour later, it was blowing 15 to 20 miles an hour. So every time he rowed, instead of going further inshore, he was going further out. Well, he got out by me and there's nothing he could do. So we started screaming and yelling. So I saw him, but I didn't go over there right away because I was going to finish the bushel of clams that I was working on. So I knew if I towed him in, I wouldn't be able to do that. So I went over there and I said, calm down. You know, he was in a panic by then. So I tied a line to his boat and we towed him in. So the guy's going, "Oh my God," he goes, "if you weren't there, I probably would have died," because it was blowing and he would have blown all the way to Fire Island. He wasn't dressed for it. He would have froze to death. It was about 28 degrees. So I told him, I said, he goes, "I'll give you anything you want, anything." I said, "I don't want anything." I said, "This is what anybody would have done. You know, you were in trouble." He got me a case of beer and he said, "Thank you so much. You saved my life." So that was another time. This is just a few of the things that happened to me out there and people that I met. I'll just talk about a few more things that are in the book. I started Clam Power. Back in the 70s. And it's kind of funny. I worked my tail off my whole life, but more people know me because of this t-shirt than anything else. And I was in school and I was reading a comic strip and it was a talking clam. And I said, you know, that gives me an idea. Back then there was like flower power, power for the people, white power. Black. So I said, I'm going to make a power shirt, right? And I drew up a bunch of sketches, picked the one I like, came back home and we silk screened these. I can still remember my wife and I did them. They were on our furniture on the couch and my friends got them and they said, oh, these are great. And the next thing I knew, they were all over the bay, but not through me. People had copied my silk screen. So people knew me through the Clam Power. That's how they knew me. So about a dozen years ago, the clamming faded out and the Clam Power faded a little bit, but my sons and I brought it back and we got a trademark on it and we have our website and we sell these and we ship them all over the country and it's been great. I meet a lot of people with like interests, you know, water stories, and I hear a lot of different things from people. And the last thing I'd like to talk about is I worked 5 years in Staten Island. The state ran a program, a depuration program, and I was 50 years old when that started. And it went from, I think, 98 to 2003 that I worked there. Now, Staten Island was a totally different ballgame. The bay was kind of fading a little. There were 10 times as many clams in Staten Island as there were in the Great South Bay. I had days there where I caught 20-something bushels of clams. The clamming was the fun part, but the commuting and the back and forth, that wasn't the fun part. You'd have to get up at 3:30 in the morning to get in there to leave the dock by 5:30. You had to come be in the dock by 1 o'clock. If you got there later, it took you forever to get home. And sometimes it was an hour and a half to 3 hours to get home on the Belt Parkway in the Southern State. So I stayed in there for 5 years. But I felt like I was part of the rat race. But it was neat to do for a while. I had a lot of stories there in the book of things that happened to me in Staten Island. I saw 9/11 happen in there right in front of our eyes. We saw the World Trade Centers go on fire. We didn't get home till like 8 o'clock that night because they opened the Verrazano Bridge. There was no one on the road when I drove home and the program shut down after that. And then the following year, they found a parasite in the clams in there, and then it shut down again. So that was the end of my Staten Island journey. I enjoyed it, but I was glad to get back on the Great South Bay. So like I said, I've been clamming for over 50 years now, and I had a great, great life, and I wouldn't trade it for anything. I loved it. I called the bay my office, and I said it's a beautiful office, and it's what I've done for my life, and that's kind of my story. Does he have to do anything? Betsy? Yeah, she's talking. I can't hear her. Wait a minute.
Sorry, I was muted. Do you want to show the video now, Steve?
Oh, yeah, you can show the video. Yeah.
Okay, let me see if I can do this. Is it showing up?
Yep, it's starting right now.
I'm going fishing, yes, I'm going fishing, and my baby going fishing too.
That was fun.
Oh, thank you. There's a little story behind that video too, if you'd like to hear that.
Yes, please.
My son's friend, his brother did the video, right? He did our website, and Rob was a man of few words. He never said too much. So what happened, he took a picture of me one day, and he made a poster out of it, and he did it for his project, his master's project in school, right? So I said, if you really want to get a feel for clamming, come out with me one day when the weather's warmer. This was like in the winter when he first did this. So he says, all right. He calls me up and he says, we're going to come out and I'm bringing my friend Mike. And he goes, we're going to take some pictures. Well, I thought he was going to come out with a camera and take some pictures. Well, he made the video, and I didn't know any idea that was going to happen. I said, oh, this is why. And then they put it on, and then he put the video on our website. So it worked out great. So he learned about what it was really like to be a clammer, and we got a great video out of it. It worked out super.
That's great.
Yeah.
Are you open to taking questions?
Sure. If anybody wants to, yeah, I'd be happy to answer whatever I can.
You can unmute, and I'm sure people have questions.
Okay.
Let's see if anyone. If you want to put your video on, you can too, so we can see you. You don't have to, but any questions? Let me look around. Well, I can get started. I have a few, if that's okay.
That's fine.
What do you think? I mean, there are a lot fewer clams now, and what do you attribute that to?
No, people ask me that all the time. Most of the scientists, everybody say there's too much nitrogen in the water, and that's probably the case. Overfishing is part of it, but you have so many people, putting fertilizer down, wanting to have the greener lawn than the neighbor. The cesspools, leaching into the ground. I know about, I don't know exactly when, 7 or 8 or 9 years ago, we had a set of clams in the bay that was like unbelievable. They were about half the size of your pinky nail. These little tiny clams. And if you lifted up a shell, you could see 8, 10, a dozen. I never saw that in 50 years. It was a tremendous set of clams. And what happened is that coincided with about a 5 or 6 month brown tide, and they all died. So that's the problem. The little clams don't survive. They don't, if they're big enough, they can survive. But to get big enough, they don't make that first step. So mm-hmm. the brown tide, we get that just about every year. And it's almost like clockwork. Every year, Memorial Day, the water turns brown. The last couple of years, we had it, so it wasn't really bad. Maybe it was a month and a half, if that. But other years, it was like five or six months. So the new inlet broke through a belt at Bellport, and the water is clearer down there. And if you do get a brown tide, it can be flushed out. It wouldn't last as long. That seems to help somewhat. Mm-hmm. As for what the real reason, I don't know 100%, but I would imagine it's a combination of things. You know, you don't have anywhere near as many wetlands and things like that. That's just the way it is. But the biggest thing is, like I said, the little clams don't set up. Now in Staten Island, when I worked in there, that area is polluted, and those clams were depurated and cleaned out. But they had a 5 foot tide down there, 5 or 6 foot. So that bay was flushed in and out and flushed in and out. And there's tons and tons of clams. So maybe the Great South Bay is a little bit too stagnant. That's not to say that it could come back again. If we get a set of clams like that again, and we don't have a bad brown tide, maybe they'll get big enough to survive, but you don't know.
Yeah. Any other questions? Any questions, anyone? You can raise your hand or you can unmute.
You can ask me some questions.
How many people do you think are doing what?
Raising their hand.
Oh, good. Go ahead. Where are you?
Hi, it's Ed. Thank you. I don't have a question, but I just an anecdote. In 1970, I worked for a company called the Cultured Clam Corporation in Dennis, Massachusetts. And three times a week, I would go to Provincetown and deliver shellfish all along Commercial Street. And every 2 weeks, I would bring 25 80-pound bags of cherry stones to the shellfish warden in P-Town. Provincetown, and load them on his boat. And first time I did it, I asked him, what are you going to do with them? And he said, I'm going to dump them in the harbor to seed the beds. And I couldn't believe it. So hundreds and hundreds of pounds of cherry stones just got dumped into the harbor for the fishermen for the fall. Yeah. But that was quite a summer. We cultivated our own cohogs and sold to all the restaurants on the Cape. But dumping those 25 pounds of cherry stones in the bay in Provincetown was really memorable to me.
Did it work?
I guess so. I hope so.
Well, you know what? The Nature Conservancy is doing that. We had a commercial property here called Blue Points Property, and they were commercial dredges, and they basically wiped the place out, and they deeded it to the Nature Conservancy, and that's what they've been doing. They put bushels of clams on there in spawner beds with the idea that that will spread out at the other parts of the Great South Bay. Like I said, if the water happens to get cleaner a little bit, that may work eventually. But that's interesting.
Yeah.
What you're saying. Yeah.
I'd just like to ask, do you see any eelgrass on the bottom of Great South Bay?
You know, no. And I don't know how many years ago when they did tests on that, the Nature Conservancy actually came out, and I had to show them the couple's eelgrass beds that there were a few left, but you just don't see any. I think the ground tide kind of just wiped that out. Now, I've heard that's coming back a little bit down towards Bellport and all that, but I can't say that 100%, but that's what I heard.
Yeah, because, you know, I'm on Shelter Island Recreational Clammer, and I worked at Meshomic for a while in the shellfish program, and we one time put 50,000 cherry stones in West Neck Bay, and they seem to be thriving, but you're right. If you put in very small clams, they don't seem to survive at all.
That's what happens.
The only one that survives are the big ones. And by the way, I read your book and I enjoyed it.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, nice.
Thank you very much.
Yep.
I'll just remind people that to learn more, you can go to clampower.org and you can see those great t-shirts and sweatshirts and order the book. So it's clampower.org.
I've got a question. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank you. My video, for some reason, is not working. Thank you to the Shelter Island Public Library for hosting this and for Stephen for sharing his thoughts. I'm a recreational clammer in Accomodic, and I usually go barefoot. And I wanted to know whether you've ever had that experience and whether you have any recommendations on how to do that, because I find myself in very somewhat deep, muddy water, and the catching is plentiful using my bare feet. I have use of the rake, of course, sometimes just to stabilize me, but I find that to be a rather intriguing way to clam. Any thoughts on that?
That's funny. Mm-hmm. I never got into the water to catch any amount of clams. If I went over to the beach when I walked in, I would do it a little bit. But I had friends who did that. That's the way they worked. We call this one guy the fish, because he was more under the water than he was above the water. And he used to catch like 8, 9, 10 bushels of clams that way. I mean, a lot of big clams, cherries and chowders and all of that. But it was amazing. He was so good at that. But what I would recommend, I know walking in from us, there's a lot of broken bottles and glass and sharp objects in there. You got to be really careful of your feet. I'm sure you've run into a few of those things yourself.
I haven't had that problem just yet. Thank you. I've been doing it for 5 or 6 years since I stopped working, and I've been okay. I think the oysters or other things might be more sharper than the glass might be in some cases.
Well, I still remember once when I was a kid and I was learning what to do, and there was a guy out there, an old timer for a long time, and he caught a bottle, right? And he broke it on the bow of his boat, and he threw it back in the water. And I said, "What are you doing?" And he goes, "Oh, that's for the treaders."
That's rather mean spirited.
Yeah, that's what they did. All right.
That's why it's a hard life.
It was a lot of time. It was every man for himself out there.
Thank you, Steve.
You're welcome.
Well, any other questions? I have one more. How do you like to make, how do you like to fix your clams? What's the best way to, no one's talked about them as food.
I like clams casino. I like them on the half shell. I like to just throw them on the grill and steam them open and put some lemon butter and garlic on them. They taste delicious. I brought about 60 clams home around Christmas time, and my son was here, and he actually and his girlfriend, they came out on the boat and helped me. And we probably ate those 60 clams in about 15 minutes.
Well, it's been a pleasure to hear your story, Steve, and I really appreciate it. Oh, Jean Stracuzzi says, thank you so much. And I want to thank you too. This has been delightful. It's so good to meet you. And thank you everyone for coming.
Thank you.
Yes.
And good night, everyone.
I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.
I'm sorry, what did you say, Steve?
I said, I hope you enjoyed it. And I wanted to thank you guys for asking me to do this.
It was a pleasure. And nice to meet you. And thank you, everyone. Good night.
Nice to meet you. Okay, good night.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good night.